high pole. This is Marion's cousin Bob. She brought him out when she came out to tell me I got that job I applied for. Bad news, Princess. I have to leave tonight.
I was supposed to be for a family. The season just started.
That's why Marion brought out her cousin Bob. He knows about both. He needs a job. And you need a new company.
You and me. Help me get out of my suit, and I'll show you home.
Okay, we'll work it out.
What I look for in a tender would be someone that can handle all the gear, the lines, you know, start the boat, move the boat, pull the anchor, balance all those balls up in the air, and know CPR, and you know how to use all the safety equipment.
I'm working on case of emergency. We work at a hospital environment here, and I have a wife and two kids. Do you have any kids? Yeah, I have a wife and a kid in college.
Well,
I mean, I'm
glad to get out
of here. I'd like to tell guys, just to make safety the main consideration. If an unstable situation is developing, then we can stop, we can examine it, we can make our moves, we can do what we have to do, and then we can continue with our harvest.
So my job is to harvest product, and your job is to be my safety backup. So I need to show you a few things. Okay? First of all, the radio ignition is channel 16 and channel 13. Here's the emergency radio call procedures. Just follow that exactly as it says, and everything will be all right.
Well, with what I've learned from the school hard knocks, I would say that the tender should know how to get on the horn and call the Coast Guard. You know, when you want the cavalry coming as fast as they can get it there, if there's a real meltdown.
When you give up position, you can run off the GPS here, and then you can get right off the track. Okay. Here's my list of emergency numbers. Don't hesitate to call those numbers. You can use your cell phones, and you can call star. Room to get a hold of the Coast Guard.
Okay. Does that work everywhere?
It doesn't work everywhere. Okay. And not only that, but all these members that other boats can't hear, so it's not doing us any good with other boats in that area. Here's a emergency procedure. We have kept an inserted bunk right inside that bunk here. Okay. It shows exactly what my duties are, what your duties are, and if anyone else is on the boat, what their duties are.
Okay.
We've got a fire extinguisher located right over here on this side of the vehicle, on the vehicle board, and we've got the other fire extinguisher right down here on the side of the vehicle. On this boat, I've got a rule that we've got to keep having on the first one, and all the things we're working on. You don't have to have the type 1 life jacket for working on deck, but do you have anything like this? If you've been working, I got a little one anyway.
I appreciate you keeping my eye on the time when you're working.
I noticed we got that Coast Guard required one thing.
I'm glad to see you brought your own emergency.
I keep mine stored right up here.
You know, if I put mine in the bunk?
Oh, that's fine.
Okay.
As long as we're doing this, let's put them on. And I'll tell you what, whoever gets on, gets those zipped up first, gets dinner made for me.
Great, but let's start in for it. Okay, can I take off my ring gear?
There's Phil, and I'll just take my foot for that.
Okay, good night.
A bit quicker to get into than one of those dry suits.
A lot faster. Let's put them away where we can get to them really quickly in an emergency.
Hey. The E-probe just got here.
Players that kept them in the starboard boat for a long time. And just forward of them is the first aid kit. Extra flares are kept here in the bottom drawer. These are expired flares. so they can't be put anywhere near the other.
Okay.
Up on top of the cabin is the life ring. A number of things you have to keep your eye on while I'm diving. One of them is the bilge level. If the water comes up to the bottom of the panel, you've got to let me know right away.
Okay.
Another one is if the hose can get fired. It can happen if the current changes, the wind changes, the boat swings around and what happens. And that can be a real danger to you.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a tool here that we use just for that purpose. This is hose away from the outside or anything else that can get on the outside. Well, what if the anchor drags? You're down below. What should I do? You got to let me know about stuff like that right away. We've got a number of ways of signaling the diver, and in a minute we're going to talk about that.
That's good.
Okay. Bob, you need to know how to start and stop the boat, put it in the case of emergency. The gas boat, so you've got to come on the blow for a good 10 seconds before you start the engine. Starts right up. The red one's the throttle. Now, put it in gear, forward, forward. Bad news is, you put it in gear and it gets my hose, I'm in deep trouble. So, I don't want to put it in gear unless it's an absolute emergency. Or unless you have to run the boat to town or something. There'll be reasons. But they'll come up later. But for now, we're just going to have the boat anchored. We'll work from that position.
Okay.
Later on, when we get better at this thing, when we get the system better, I'm going to have the anchor up and you're going to be following my bubbles. That's a really nice system. I think you're going to enjoy it. So I'm going to tell you how to operate the winch. Here's the hydraulic valve. Down, down, up, down, way down. It's important that when you're lifting a heavy load, you keep the load close to the boat. Because if it swings out, it's got leverage advantage. You're going to want to put the load in.
There's several things that are really important to me as far as what my tender should know. Number one, I guess I'd like him to know how to operate the boat properly, you know, how to start it, how to anchor it, that sort of thing. Number two, get to the dive gear. And I guess the number one thing is want to make sure he knows how to put the air coming to it. And then you have all the other things, you know, how to coil hose, how to signal me down below, that sort of thing.
Okay, I'm getting ready to get in the water. When I'm getting ready to get in the water, and when I'm in the water, isn't the time to be taking a break. We could go up on the rocks by dragging anchor. The wind's blowing, we swing around, if my hose can get fouled, you need to be getting really close attention.
Okay. I mean, it's all kinds of bad stuff can happen, so I can't overstress how important that is to know what's going on and be aware of it. What's going around, and kind of a little zone around the boat.
When I get in the water, I'm going to note the time and get all the way
there. Okay.
It's important that you keep an eye on the depth at all times. When I get in the water, if the current and the wind are affecting me, I need to be able to get to the boat, so you've got to call me with my hose back to the boat. You got to know where I'm at all times. So watch the position for a time and watch my bubble. Let me ask you about sea lions or turtle whales. What if I see one? What should I do? Let me know right away.
One particular incident I recall where a tender came to my aid was just last year when, while diving, we encountered a herd of killer whales moving in our direction. The tender spotted us and immediately gave me two tugs on the nose. I responded with two tugs. And that was an indicator that get back to the boathouse as quickly as possible.
This is a dive marker flag. Other boats are supposed to stay 100 feet away from it.
We were diving. I was on the bottom. I've been working deep most of the day, down 70 feet. And we were on the last dive of the day. I was up to about 45 feet. And heard the boat came over. I looked at it and I'm thinking, he's going to grab my hose because he didn't slow down. And he went past and thought he must have missed me. I was going to start kicking again, and all of a sudden I just shot backwards. And obviously the tender, I think he went down below, he said, to get a pack of cigarettes. And he did not see what was going on.
If they start to get near my hose or my bubble, which you've got to keep an eye on, you've got to let them know to stay away.
He's driving it down about 50 feet. And the first one, the wild engine's approaching, but not near enough to do a, you know, to do a Frankenstein. And then a great, a really dark cloud passed, and it stopped and paused, and I looked up, and nothing seemed to be happening, so it passed, and I just went on picking. But when I returned to the surface, I found out that a large log rat had passed us, and the operator of the log rat had called my boat to tell that we were in a bad position, that he needed us to move. And the dive tender made the decision not to pull me up. We could have pulled up and been out of there quickly, and it could have cost safety, but as it was, it would put us in a dangerous position and difficult to keep the log rat.
Where are we communicating with the dive radio? We put it over on number 2. Here's the mic. I see it when you're talking to me. You use it when I'm talking to you. But sometimes the comms go down. And when they do, we need to have other methods of signaling. When I'm on the surface, I'm going to be using visual signals. For example, my hand on top of my head means I'm okay. Waving like this means I've got a problem. My clenched fist means stop whatever action you're taking. My finger pointing to my hand means I've got an air problem with an air issue. But there's more signals, and I want you to take the time to learn them all. Then there's my hose signals, which are what we use when I'm on the bottom. For example, 3 poles means pick up my clock. There's quite a few more, as you can see here, so we're going to get them all done. These are the dive tables. I use these to stay within my safe diving corner. You need to become familiar with the compressor because that's my air supply. There's the switch, there's the choke.
Okay.
Now, you got to keep a good eye on where the intake hose is located because sometimes if the wind shifts or the current shifts, the exhaust could get into my air intake. You got to make sure it stays above 100 pounds on this particular compressor. While you're near the compressor, keep your clothes and your boots away from this thing. It'll eat you alive.
What if it dies? I'm hoping it dies. What do I do?
If it dies, I've got 3 to 5 minutes of bottom time, but you're going to have to let me know immediately.
If the compressor quits, we have a callback. We just say, give us 3 and we're out of the water. And that means to remove all the slack and give us 3 and we're out.
We have a reserve tank, so if the compressor quits, we still have, you know, 3 or 4 minutes of air left. And we all work the diver by my work, all work air at that. Under here is a volume tank, which gives me like 3 to 5 minutes of fill to come out. I've also got the bailout bottle. That gives me another 5 minutes depending on the depth. You need to drain the volume tank at the end of every day. So throughout the day, you want to see the water separated a little bit. Especially in the winter, you need to do it often because if I get water in my lines, it'll freeze and it'll block my liquid. One instance, as I recall, during a cold February morning, our lines froze up. I was down around 70 feet. Well, without any air, I rocketed to the surface. Fortunately, at that time, the tender was well acquainted with how the boat operated, was able to retrieve the anchor and motor over to go ahead and assist getting me out of the water. Divers can experience a wide variety of different medical problems, and most of them revolve around pressure and changes of pressure. Divers experience problems with their ears. Most divers are familiar with that. Many other problems can occur. You can experience decompression illness, which can affect the skin, which will itch like crazy.
you can experience severe pains in the joints, which is from gas coming out of solution into the joints that bends. You can experience serious life-threatening problems with the lungs.
We pertain to purposes of a dive tender, we may realize how important it is for us to have air on the bottom. Now, in the event that we should fail to get air on the bottom, and we should come to the surface either slowly or in a hurry, I would like you dive tender to know how to call 911 if I'm unconscious. If I'm conscious, I should be able to relate to them what I need. But if I'm unconscious, I need to know where we are, and what the nature of the emergency is, and how to use the VHF radio. Hopefully, we won't have any dive emergencies, but if we do, we need to know how to use the radio to call the Coast Guard. Also, you need to familiarize yourself with the life sling, because if I'm incapacitated, my weight can be awfully difficult to handle, and you need to use a mechanical advantage.
Okay, now, so now what do I do with the line?
Just put it in the ball there, Bob. Pass it underneath the roller. Now, Bob, if I come up not breathing, be sure and do a pulse check. And if I need it, do CPR. You have your updated CPR card, don't you?
Yep, that's okay.
All right, we're doing good here.
What on a perfect word when you don't have somebody from the ER to talk to you to take care of that is one of those people. I would like the dive chamber to know to save my life. We did not have supplemental oxygen, but if I have another new going, we will.
I need to show you how the oxygen works. You've got a tank, you've got a regulator, you've got a mask. If there's other boats in the area, you need to get in touch with them right away because they might have oxygen thirsty land. Now, this is a D-sized bottle. Time on this tank is only about 22 minutes at best at a 10 to 15 liter flow rate. Don't be an oxygen miser because I'm going to move off the bottom.
What should I do with the cylinder? Where should I place it?
Always keep it on its side so it doesn't fall over. It's not contents under a lot of pressure, so you don't want to put your body over the top of it. In order to use it, you don't want to put any oil products that open flame anywhere near oxygen at any time. To attach it, crack it just a little bit to get rid of any debris in the lines. Stretch the gasket to make sure it's in good shape. And whatever you do, don't ever try to use a different kind of regulator on an oxygen bottle. You attach the regulator, and you attach the hose to the nipple. Open the tank valve. Open the valve to a high flow rate. And if the mask has an oxygen reservoir, let it fill first. And place it over my face.